right, Deb, we good? All right, we had some technical difficulties there, so we got a little bit behind, but that's okay. We got the devil kicked out of the internet, and now we're going to get started tonight. So, y'all keep praying because we know the world and the devil doesn't want us to have this class, but we're going to have it anyway, and we believe that greater is he that's in us than he that's in the world. And so, as we were saying a while ago, tonight is semester three. This is our night one. We're going to be going over New Testament Survey 1. That's going to be one of our new classes. We're going to have teaching the Bible. You're going to learn how to teach the Bible. You say, well, I'm not going to be a teacher. If you're a parent or a grandparent, this lesson is going to apply to you all semester. And then pastor's going to be teaching on the Christian home. And so three good sets of classes we have tonight. Now tonight with our New Testament class, once you get your Bible out and turn the book of Matthew, and we'll begin our New Testament survey. But tonight only, we won't have any PowerPoint shows for tonight because tonight's an introduction lesson. So we don't have PowerPoints for that. We're going to try to cover a little bit. We're getting about a 10-minute late start, so we might be 10 minutes over tonight, but that's okay. We've got a few here with us, and we've got a few joining by live stream, so we thank you for joining us tonight. So let's pray, and we'll get right into our New Testament Survey 1. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for this night. Thank you for the opportunity to be in your house. And Lord, thank you, Lord, to be able to bring this class, Lord, to our people in the church and those via live stream. And so, Lord, we pray that people be faithful to study the Word of God. That's our desire. That's our goal. So however we can do that to enable our people to learn the Bible, that's what we need in these wicked days. So Father, we're in trying days in our country. And Lord, our world's in a mess, our country's in a mess, our government's in a mess. But Lord, the only thing solid and stable that we have in our lives is the Lord Jesus Christ. And so our hope's there, our hope's built on the Bible. So Lord, the more that we know about the Bible, the more we'll be able to spot deception, the more we'll be able to be anchored in these days. So Lord, help that to be our goal. Give us wisdom as we try to teach and impart truth in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, so Matthew, we're going to look at the Gospels tonight. We're actually going to do two lessons in one. There's two introductory lessons. So in your books, it's going to be lesson one and two, but we're going to put those together, kind of like we did two of the Old Testament books. And then from here on out, we'll have every night to devote one night to one book of the Bible, because there's less of the New Testament book, so therefore we can devote more time. So in New Testament Survey 1, we're going to start our introduction tonight. We're going to talk about the introduction to the New Testament and then the introduction to the four Gospels. Next week, Lord willing, we're going to look at the book of Matthew. And then as we finish out this semester, we're going to finish out with the book of Ephesians, okay? And then in the fall, we'll pick up with Philippians and then go through the book of Revelation. So this semester, we're going to do Matthew through Ephesians, and tonight we're doing introductions. So there's no slides. Now, those of you who signed up for the class who attend Maranatha Baptist Church, we provide you with the additional notes. We're going to be using that tonight for those that are here. We can't provide that for everybody, the shipping and things. We're just not able to do that. But for those of you who come to Maranatha Baptist Church, we want you to participate here, and those are available for those who buy the courses. So we want you to do that, and we'll be going through a lot of your additional notes tonight. Now, the introduction to the New Testament. Now, remember, we just finished up the Old Testament back in December as we finished up the book of Malachi. But as you're going to see, when we get to the book of Matthew, Matthew picks up exactly where Malachi leaves off. And so we'll get into that next week. Now, turn to lesson one in your new books, your New Testament Survey 1, and we're going to see the dominating idea of the New Testament, the concept of the New Testament is fulfillment. And so the Old Testament has set the stage now. Everything's been prophesied concerning the coming Messiah and Jesus coming to this earth and his work and life and ministry. And now in the New Testament, we find these things unfolding. And so the New Testament is going to be the fulfillment of the Old Testament. Okay, so we're going to look at a few of these. Matthew gives this emphasis. The book of Matthew gives the emphasis on this, on fulfillment. And the words "that it might be fulfilled in some form or fashion" is used 12 times through the book of Matthew. Let's look at some of those tonight. I want you to go to Matthew chapter 1 and verse 22 to get this idea in your head that the New Testament is a fulfillment of the Old Testament. There are those today that teaches this replacement theology and stuff, that the church has taken the place of Israel and the Old Testament is no longer important. That's a false doctrine. The Old and New Testament go hand in hand. You can't understand the New without the Old. You can't have the Old without the New to understand those things. And so it's fulfillment in Matthew 1:22, and this is the birth of Christ. Now all this was done that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the Lord, by the prophet, saying, Behold, a virgin shall be with child, and shall bring forth a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which being interpreted is God with us. And so where was that prophesied? In the book of Isaiah. Now we find it being fulfilled, especially here in the book of Matthew. Look in chapter 2, verse 15. Chapter 2 and verse 15. In verse 14 and 15, when he arose, he took the young child and his mother by night, and they departed into Egypt, and they were there until the death of Herod, that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken of the Lord by the prophet, saying, Out of Egypt I have called my son. So in the book of Hosea, that's prophesied, and now we see it fulfilled in the life of Christ. Now, let's look there in verse 17, that same chapter, or look at verse 16. Speaking about Herod here. Then Herod, when he saw that he was mocked of the wise men, he was exceeding wroth and sent forth and slew all of the children that were in Bethlehem and in all the coasts thereof from 2 years old and under, according to the time which he had diligently inquired of the wise men. Look in verse 17. Then was fulfilled that which was spoken by Jeremy the prophet, or Jeremiah, saying, In Ramah there was a voice heard lamentation and weeping and great mourning, Rachel weeping for her children, and would not be comforted because they are not. And so you can look at the rest of these. They're in your book. And for sake of time, since we're getting started a little bit late and we kind of got a lot to cover, I planned on teaching two lessons. We're going to move on. So in the book of Matthew 12 times. And then not just exclusively to Matthew, but you find that all through the New Testament. This idea of the fulfillment of the Old Testament prophecies, or many of them, concerning Christ. Okay, now we understand some of these prophecies are yet to be fulfilled, they're future, but this is the theme of the New Testament. They either are being fulfilled or they will be fulfilled, okay? Letter C. Christ's first words of his earthly ministry shows this emphasis as well. While you're there in the book of Matthew, look in chapter 3 and verse 15. Just look at a few of these. So Christ places emphasis on this. And Jesus answering said unto him, Suffer it to be so now, for thus it becometh us to fulfill what? All righteousness. And then he suffered him. And so we see that that Jesus, he fulfilled, he spoke this. That's why he came, to fulfill the Scriptures. And we can see later, as we'll look at later on in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, that Christ died what? According to the Scriptures. He was buried and rose again the third day according to the Scriptures. And so what we're trying to teach you tonight is the New Testament has this idea of fulfillment of the Old Testament. And so if the Word of God's going to be true, then what was the test of the Old Testament? Pastor went over this in the book of Exodus, and we've talked about in the Old Testament, their prophecies had to come to pass. And so every one concerning Christ we see fulfilled. The Christ of the New Testament is the answer to the Old Testament. And so let's move on. The Christ of the New Testament is the answer to the Old Testament. Roman numeral 2 in lesson 1 here. The relationship of the Old and New Testaments. Now, without the New Testament, the Bible is a book of... Now, you have four things right here. This is from our book, J. Sidlow Baxter. That's the one of the research books that not everybody has, but where your additional notes come from. The majority of your additional notes come from that book, Exploring the Book by J. Sidlow Baxter. And so I try to get that out. I understand that everybody can't buy the books, and they're kind of expensive, so I try to get that to you. But notice what he says. Without the New Testament, the Bible is... the books of the law, that's Genesis through Deuteronomy, are just five books of unexplained ceremonies. Genesis through Deuteronomy, or Exodus through Deuteronomy, those books don't make sense. What was the sacrifices all about? What was the purpose of the Passover? What was the purpose of them coming out of Egypt? It doesn't make sense without the New Testament. And then number two, unachieved purposes, the 12 books of history. Why did God raise up a king? Why did God raise up a nation? Why did God send prophets if there's no New Testament and there's no explanation to that? The five books of the poetry, that would be unappeased longings. The psalmist crying out for God and hoping in his Redeemer that his soul wouldn't be left in hell and in corruption. If the New Testament's not real, if Christ is not coming, then all of that's empty promises and longings. And then unfulfilled prophecies, the 17 books of prophecies we studied, would be all in vain. if there's no New Testament. So the Old Testament says someone is coming. Do y'all have that in your book below there? And then the New Testament says that someone has come, and that's the Lord Jesus Christ. So the Old Testament is primarily, his job is pointing us to the future coming of Jesus Christ. But now in the New Testament says here he is. And now you and I, we look back as Jesus came. Look in John chapter 1 and verse 41. John chapter 1 and verse 41. They were looking for Messiah, and sadly he came and they rejected him. But look in John 1:41. This is when Jesus is calling his disciples there. And he first findeth his own brother Simon, this is Andrew, and he saith unto him, we have found the Messiah, so that's Messiah, which being interpreted is the Christ. And so Andrew's telling Simon, he says, the Christ is here, Messiah is here. The Old Testament prophet said he's coming, he's coming. Andrew's telling Peter, Peter, we found him, he's here. Here he is. And that's what the whole New Testament's about, presenting Christ in the flesh. Okay, all right, next page, letter B here under Roman numeral 2. The connection between the two testaments may be described like this. Prophecy in the Old Testament is history in the New Testament. And so these things that were yet future, that Isaiah prophesied about the coming Messiah, he would be born of a virgin, that he would die, and the Psalms and all these things that David talked about, the Lord would die on a cross, that was prophecy in the Old Testament. But when we come to the New Testament, that's now history because it's being fulfilled. Number two, the hope in the Old Testament is fact in the New Testament. They were hoping for the Messiah. Now here he is. It's fact. Number three, expectancy in the Old Testament is experience in the New Testament. Now they had the chance, and you know, as John would write later, he said, our eyes have seen, our ears have heard, and our hands have handled the word of life. And so now this Messiah they was looking for, John said, we've heard him, we've seen him, we've touched him, and he's real. And so through experience. Number three, the structure of New Testament books. And so we're just kind of going through this tonight, and it's just kind of an introduction, and so there's no nothing really to write down and stuff. So those of you listening don't have books. I may be going a little bit fast, but we have a lot of ground to cover. But Jehovah, now notice this out to your right here. There's a little box here. Jehovah of the Old Testament is who? Jesus of the New Testament. And boy, if there's any Jehovah Witnesses listening tonight, that's going to ruffle their feathers because they don't believe that. But Jehovah of the Old Testament is Jesus of the New Testament. He's God. He's co-equal, co-eternal, co-existent, eternally existent with God the Father and God the Holy Spirit. And so we believe that, we know that, and that's what the whole Bible presents to us, okay? And then number three, the structure of these New Testament books. Letter A, we have the five historical books. Now we're talking about the New Testament. These books provide the historical account of Christ and His church. So that's Matthew through Acts, okay? We find the life and ministry of Christ. And then the book of Acts, we find the Holy Spirit working in and through His church, the church history. They gave the record of Christ's birth, His sinless life, His earthly ministry, His betrayal and crucifixion, His resurrection and His ascension. We find this all in these books, these historical books of the New Testament for us. The book of Acts gives record of the spreading of the gospel and the establishing of local churches during the first years of the church age, okay? And so here we are, how many, 20 centuries later, and the church of the living God is still going. And Jesus said the gates of hell will not prevail against it, amen? And so no matter what administration's in the White House, the church of the living God is going to continue to go forth. And so we find that in Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, and Acts. Letter B, then we come to the nine Christian church epistles. Now we're going to be getting more into this as we go through these books of the Bible, okay? So we're just kind of giving you the glaze on the donut tonight. You'll get the donut next week, you're getting the glaze tonight, okay? And so we're giving you an introduction. So there's nine Christian church epistles. These books provide specific doctrine for local churches. They include teachings on the subject of salvation, Christian living, the local church, giving, the second coming of Christ, just to name a few. And so the nine church epistles are going to be Romans through 2 Thessalonians. They're written by the Apostle Paul. They deal with church doctrine. This is what we need to be emphasizing in our the day in which we live is the doctrine. It's important. And then if you look on the next page, we have the four pastoral or personal epistles. These epistles were written to individuals and not churches. Now, you'll find Romans through 2 Thessalonians were written to specific church groups, to actual local churches. And then, of course, they have spiritual applications for all the churches. But then when we come to pastoral epistles, 1 Timothy through Philemon, then we see that they're written to individuals personally. And of course, we see that in the names, written to Timothy and Titus, Philemon. And pastoral epistles, how to run the church and what the pastor's and deacon's responsibilities are, we find those in those books. And then the last nine of the Hebrew Christian epistles, that's James through Revelation, these epistles contain teaching especially directed toward believing Jews, but their truths have applications to all Christians. And these are some of the practical applications of Christianity, like the book of James and Peter. We find a lot of these. But understand, in order to understand the context, we have to understand who the writer is writing to, what audience or what group. Now, we understand that all the Bible is for us, or not for us, but to us. No, all the Bible is for us, but not exactly to us. And so there were different people groups, and we're going to show you that here just in a minute. And so they were written to two specific audiences, but they're for all of us, okay? I got my West Virginia hillbilly tongue tied there. But they were written for us because all Scripture's written for our learning and our admonition. But it wasn't necessarily written to us as an audience. So we have to understand how to rightly divide that, and we can draw spiritual application from all the books of the Bible, as we'll see, okay? And so the 27 books of the New Testament, they completed God's written revelation of Himself to man. Okay, all right, so that's kind of the introduction of the New Testament. Now, let's jump in the remaining time, perhaps maybe about the next 10, 15 minutes here on the next lesson. That'll be lesson two in your book, is the introduction to the gospel records. And we'll spend a little bit of time here, and we kind of just breeze through the introduction of the New Testament. The reason being, we're going to be getting into that more detail as we get through those individual books. And now that we don't have to do two books a night like we did in the Old Testament, where we had 39 books, now we can do spend a little bit more time individually in the New Testament. So lesson two, introduction to the gospel records. That's Matthew through John. Okay, we refer to these books of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John as the gospel records because they provide the scriptural record of the death, burial, and resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. In order for something to be legitimate, especially in a court of law, you need to have proof. You need to have documentation. You know, I don't know how many times in the workplace, in the military, documentation. You got to document. If you didn't document it, it didn't happen. And so the Bible has its documentation of the life and the death and the burial and resurrection and ascension of Jesus Christ. And so that's what the gospel records give us, Matthew through John. And so what is the gospel? When we say gospel, what does that mean? Well, Paul defines that for us in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. I want you to turn there. These are familiar verses tonight, but we're refreshing ourselves in the gospel and these basic truths. And sometimes we have to go back to the basics before we can move forward. We need to know why we believe. And boy, now more than ever, we need to know the Bible and what it means. And we need to be imparting truth. You know, I heard Pastor Sexton, he said this last week in a video watched, you know, and he was challenging preachers and teachers of the Bible. And he's saying the effectiveness of your church or how you can rank your church as it's doing what God's called you to do is if you are relaying truth to your people, that's one side of it, but then your church is being effective only if your people is taking that truth and sharing it with people out in their world and their networks. And so that's our job to teach you and communicate truth to you, but it's your job to take that truth out into the world, to your families, to your workplace, to your people network that you know, and to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ. So what's the gospel? 1 Corinthians 15:1. Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I preached unto you, which you have also received, and wherein you stand, by which also you are saved, if you keep in memory that which I preached unto you, unless ye have believed in vain. For here's the gospel. For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins, look, according to what? The Scriptures. And was buried, and He was buried, and He rose again the third day according to the Scriptures. Okay, so that's the gospel. The death, the burial, and the resurrection of Christ. In Matthew through John, we see that experience. We see Christ in His life, in His death, His burial and resurrection. And then in the book of Acts, we see that message going out into the world as they're taking the gospel to the world, as we still are today. So why are there four gospel records. Why didn't God just use one? Well, if we look at creation, we can clearly see that God is a God of diversity. And you know, he didn't make all the trees in the fall to be the same color. He didn't make all the fish in the sea to look the same. And so God is using and allowing, and if you'll study the Bible and you study these men that God used to pen the Bible, we know and we understand that the Holy Spirit, He's the divine author, He's the one that inspired it, but God allowed men to write from their own personal feelings and from their, like we're reading, studying the book of Jeremiah, for instance, on our Bible study, the weeping prophet, and Jeremiah put his heart into that in his writings, and you'll find Paul pouring out his heart many times to the people that he's communicating with. And all of these people, even though God uses us all in one body, God allows us to use our individual characteristics and traits to use and accomplish His work. And that's why God did this. Now, that's going to make more sense here just in a minute, so bear with me. Number one, it's to provide a complete view of Christ. These four records are four portraits of the Messiah. Together, they give us a complete view and full description of our Lord. If we just had the Gospel of Matthew, then there's a whole lot of things that we learn about in John and Luke that we wouldn't have if we just had Matthew. If we just had Mark, that's the shortest book. It's the most action-packed book in the Bible. But it's the shortest. We wouldn't have all the conversations and the teachings that Christ did in the other books. And so it's a full portrait. So think about that when you read it. And I just went through here not too long ago with our teenagers several months back. We went through the last days of Jesus on earth, and we were teaching and looking at all the different Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, because in order to get the big picture, to know what happened, especially around the Lord's crucifixion, you have to look at them all as a whole. Okay, and so that's why, to get a full portrait, number two, to communicate the gospel message to different audiences. And we're going to get into that here just in a moment. In the days of Christ, there were three main cultural groups, the Jews, the Greeks, and the Romans, and each of these groups are specifically targeted in the gospel records because all men need to hear the gospel. Now, that's going to make more sense when we get to the next page, so park that thought. But it was because of the audiences. Now, remember, each book of the Bible wasn't written exactly to us, but it's for us, okay? But it was written to specific people, so we have to understand that. Okay, number three, to confirm the gospel message. A message of such importance as the gospel is confirmed with four independent witnesses who all verified the same truth without contradiction. So you'll find Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and even though one will have more than the other, and this one will have a tidbit that the other one didn't have, but when you look at them all together, they all put together one complete picture. They don't contradict one another. These were four individuals, and they have four witnesses of Jesus Christ, and their testimonies harmonize. They work together, okay? So now look on the next page. The page after that will be the one I was telling you about. But number four, it is to clarify and complete the record of Christ. Throughout each book, though each book can stand alone as a valid record, taken together, they clarify and complete one another. Some books include details about persons and events that other books do not. And again, we're going to get that here just in 1 minute. Number five, the reason that they're different is to provide a large quantity of content concerning Christ. If the story of Jesus Christ is the central message of all the Bible, and it is, then it is reasonable to understand that the Lord would give us a large portion of Scripture containing or concerning Christ and His work. One account of Christ would have been much shorter, but God intended to emphasize the gospel message in His Word by giving so much Scripture to deal with it. So the four gospel records provide a complete view of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, notice this at the bottom. Notice God's emphasis in Scripture. Now, we've learned when God says something more than once, what's He doing? He's placing emphasis, importance on it. The gospel records make up 50% of the New Testament. Of 89 chapters of the gospel records, only four deal with the first 30 years of Christ's earthly life. So really, from Christ's birth until he's 30 years old and the baptism where he's baptized by John and he enters his earthly ministry, there's only four chapters of those 89 chapters that even deal with that part of Christ's life. Why? Well, it's not just the Bible's a book of redemption, and Christ came for a work. And we're going to find the work that Christ did was centered around those last 3.5 years of his life. That was the importance, okay? And so the 85 chapters deal with his last 3 years. And so 4 years, or excuse me, four chapters, only out of 89 deal with his first 30 years, but the remaining 85 chapters deal with his last 3 years. 27 of these chapters deal specifically with the last 8 days of his life leading to the crucifixion. Did you get that? So 27, that's a big chunk of whatever 89 chapters, however, whatever that percentage is, that would at least be what, a third or more? Almost a third of these gospel records centers around the last 8 days of Jesus' life. Okay, so now look at this next page. This is what I was trying to get to. This is why I'm pushing to kind of get to tonight and kind of finish off here. Let's do a comparison. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. So you have a table, and what's that? Oh, you have a table, and we'll see Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John across this. Now we're going to see the different groups they were written to and why they were written that way. Now, Matthew presents Jesus as the King of the Jews. Okay, this is important to remember in studying your Bible. Understand why the book of Matthew is written the way it is and to who it's written to. He presents Christ as the King of the Jews and to rule and to reign. Okay, that's not in your box there, but I want you to write that there. To rule and to reign. Christ came to rule and to reign. And so in the book of Matthew, he's presented as King. He is shown, if you look at the next column down, we're just going to go Matthew down before we get to Mark. And so he's presented as the King of the Jews, and he's the son of David. Now remember, we're talking about connecting and fulfilling Old Testament prophecies under the Davidic covenant in 2 Samuel. We find that God promised David that the Messiah would come and would set upon his throne and establish it forever. And so the book of Matthew is showing that Jesus is the son of David that was prophesied. The primary audience that it's written to is to the Jewish people. Okay, and so to the Jew first. And so Matthew is primarily written to a Jewish audience. Does that mean we can't learn from Matthew? Does that mean Matthew's not apply to us or for us? No. We read the Beatitudes. There's many things, parables we read about in Matthew. But understand this, Matthew is a Jewish man, and his goal is to primarily reach a Jewish audience. Now, we learn from Matthew, and it's for us, but it was written to them to present Christ as King of the Jews. Now, he's presented as the Lion, okay, the Lion. Now, if you go back, and if you'll look into the book of Ezekiel real quick, and this will hold true for the rest of these, let's just look at Ezekiel chapter 1 and verse 10. Pastor went through this when he taught through the book of Ezekiel. Remember the seeing his glory there in chapter number 1 and the seraphims and the cherubs and all the things that we were introduced to there. But notice here in Ezekiel 1:10, one of these seraphims, and as for the likeness of their faces, they four had the face of a man and the face of a lion, and on the right side, and they four had the face of an ox on the left side, and they four also had the face of an eagle. So notice that, the lion, the ox, the man, and the eagle. And if you go over to Revelation chapter 4 and verse 7, you find those seraphims again in heaven, in the heavenly scene there, and you find the face of a lion, the face of an ox, the face of a man, the face of an eagle. You say, well, what in the world does that have to do with the New Testament? What does that have to do with Jesus? Well, let's put it together here in the book of Matthew. Matthew is writing to the Jews. He presents Christ as King of the Jews, the Son of David, and Jesus is represented as the Lion. And so one of those figures and those images on the seraphim, they have four faces. One of them's a lion. And so remember, Jesus is the what? The Lion of the tribe of Judah. And so we find that in the book of Matthew. Now the emphasis of Matthew's gospel is on the teachings of Jesus. Each one of the gospels emphasizes on a different point, but remember, they make a complete picture. And so in the book of Matthew, he's emphasizing the teachings of Jesus Christ. That's why we have, three chapters dedicated to the Sermon on the Mount. And we have all the parables and things that Jesus is teaching. So a big portion of that teaching about the kingdom. The king is teaching about the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of God. A lot of that you find in the book of Matthew. Now, I want you to see this. I found this today. It's not in your notes, but I want you to add this to put you another box. Those of you that has a book, in your Matthew column, put you another box underneath the book of Matthew. And I come across this today, and this was really good. And I hadn't noticed this before. But I want you to hold your place in Matthew and go back to the book of Zechariah, chapter 9 and verse 9. Now remember, What we said at the beginning tonight, the New Testament is focusing on fulfilling the Old Testament prophecies, okay? And so Matthew is presenting Jesus as king, so go back to Zechariah. Hopefully it won't be that hard to find. Just a few minutes ago we were studying this. So Zechariah chapter 9 and verse 9. Now notice this. Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout, O daughter of Jerusalem. What's the next three words? Behold thy king. Cometh unto thee, and he is just and having salvation, lowly and riding upon an ass and upon a colt and the foal of an ass. So Zechariah says, behold your king cometh. Matthew's presenting him saying, behold the king, he's here. This is Jesus. Okay, so write Zechariah 9:9 under Matthew. And I'm going to show you the other three. Now let's go up to the top again, back to the book of Mark. Let's go to the book of Mark now. In your second column, you'll have the book of Mark. Mark, Jesus is presented as the suffering servant. He came to serve and to suffer. He came to serve and to suffer. So the book of Mark, where Matthew portrays and puts emphasis on Christ as king, then we find in the book of Mark that Jesus presented as a servant. Now, one thing we didn't say back in the book of Matthew, if you go back and look at the genealogy of Matthew, it goes all the way back in Matthew. Christ's genealogy and his lineage starts at Abraham. We'll get into a little bit of that when we get in the book of Matthew next week. But the genealogy of Christ only goes back to Abraham in Matthew. Why is that important? Abraham's the father of what people group? The Jews, right? And so who's Matthew writing to? He's writing to the Jews. That's why the lineage of Christ only goes back to Abraham. And then he's presented as the son of David in that lineage there. Now, in the book of Mark, if you notice in the book of Mark, Mark chapter 1, boom, we jump right into Christ's earthly ministry and he's at work, he's casting out devils, he's doing miracles, and there's no birth record in the book of Mark. Why is that? Well, Mark is writing to a Roman audience and he's presenting, Mark's a Roman, and he's presenting to a Roman audience, and to the Roman, a servant had no background. They wasn't interested in a servant's past. They wasn't interested in their lineage because a servant was not portrayed to them. It was, and not to say Christ's life wasn't important, but understand the audience that he's writing to. And so Mark is the most action-packed of all the Gospels, and we'll see that. And you'll find the words straightway and immediately over and over is the key words in those books. Now Mark, as we said, writes to the Romans, and as we look at that seraphim, Matthew presented Christ as the lion, but Mark would represent Jesus as the ox. And so what's the ox? Doing the work, doing the labor. And so in the book of Mark, Christ is busy. We find more miracles, even though Mark's the smallest book of the Gospels, we find more miracles recorded in the book of Mark and the others. And so we find Christ at work. He's busy serving. He's busy working, doing the work that the Father had given him to do, the servant of God. And so he's represented as the symbol of the ox. And then the emphasis on the book of Mark is on Christ's miracles. Where Matthew is on Christ's teachings, in the book of Mark, the miracles are is presenting Christ through his miracles. Now, I want you to add another box below Mark, if you would. I'm almost finished. We go through these last two, and we'll be finished with this tonight. But I want you to add another box, and then I want you to go back to the Old Testament, the book of Isaiah, chapter 42. Now, remember, we said tonight that the New Testament, the emphasis is the fulfillment of the Old Testament. So we saw in Zechariah, behold the king. But now, these last four, I come across this studying day. It was a blessing to me, and I just want to share this with you. In Isaiah 42:1, notice what the Bible says. What? Behold my servant, whom I uphold, mine elect, and whom my soul delighteth, I have put my spirit upon him, and he shall bring forth judgment to the Gentiles. And all of these passages are speaking of Christ. And so Zechariah said, behold, your king cometh. Now Isaiah said, behold, my servant. And this is God, Jehovah, speaking. And so we find this in the book of Mark, the servant coming. Now up to the book of Luke, if you'll go to your third column down, we'll look at the gospel according to Luke. You know, I've had to break myself in the habit. We get in the habit of saying things. I don't think we intentionally mean to say it wrongly, but we say the Gospel of Matthew, the Gospel of Mark, the Gospel of Luke, the Gospel of John. That's kind of biblically not correct because it's not the Gospel of Matthew. It's the Gospel according to Matthew. It's the gospel according to Mark. It's the gospel according to Luke. So make no understanding about that, that we're not presenting Matthew's life and ministry, we're presenting Christ. So it's according to these men. So Luke, now we come to the book of Luke, Christ is presented as the perfect man. In the book of Matthew, he's presented as the King of the Jews. The book of Mark, the suffering servant. But in the book of Luke, the perfect man. And he came to share and sympathize. We find more about Christ's feelings and his sympathy and him reaching out to the outcast. In the book of Luke, he's reaching out to humanity because he came to seek and to save that which was lost. We find the caring Savior reaching out and touching the lepers. We find that in the book of Luke because he's the perfect man. He came to share and to sympathize his message. In the book of Luke, we find Jesus presented as the Son of Man. You know the most favorite saying that, or the most favorite title that Jesus used to speak of himself was the Son of Man. The Son of Man. And in Luke's record of Christ's genealogy, Luke goes past Abraham and Luke goes all the way back to Adam, thank God. Because you see, Jesus didn't just come for the Jews. Matthew goes back to Abraham because Matthew's reaching a Jewish audience, and it's important to them to focus that because they put all of their emphasis and stock on Abraham and Moses, and so Matthew ties Christ to that. But I'm glad in the book of Luke that the Lord allowed him to go all the way back to the genealogy of Adam. Remember in Genesis 3:15, the promise was given of a redeemer to Eve and Adam in the garden when they sinned that the seed of the woman would bruise the head of the serpent. And so Jesus goes all the way back, his lineage, to Adam, connecting him to not only the Jewish people, but the entire human race. You see, until Abraham, there wasn't a Jewish people. It was just humanity, mankind that was one. Okay, we came from one family, Adam, and then after that, one family, Noah. And so we're all connected. It wasn't until Abraham that God pulled out a nation. And so understand that Christ came for us. And so Luke, he's a Greek, and he writes primarily to the Greek people. So understand that as he's writing. And then the third side of that seraphim, the lion, the ox, and the man. And so Christ is the perfect man. Now it's interesting, we'll talk about in the book of Luke, that the Greeks, now remember he's writing to a Greek audience, the Greeks was very interested in human life. They were interested in intelligence and developing the perfect mind, the perfect man. They were interested in these games and athletics, the perfect male body, the perfect intellectual capacity and all that. And here he is. Luke represents Jesus to the Greeks as the perfect man. And that's who Christ was, okay? And so he's the man. The emphasis in Luke is on Christ's parables. He's teaching the people. Christ used parables, common ordinary things, to relate spiritual truth to his people. And so he's connecting with humanity. And then let's go back to the Old Testament, back in the book of Zechariah, chapter number 6. Zechariah chapter 6. Now remember the Old Testament or the New Testament fulfillment of the Old Testament prophecies, but in Zechariah chapter 6 and verse 12, "And speak unto him, saying, Thus speaketh the Lord of hosts, saying, Behold the man." Now behold the king, behold the servant, behold the man whose name is the branch, and he shall grow up out of his place, and he shall build the temple of the Lord. Notice branch is in all caps. It's speaking of Jesus Christ, the Messiah. So he is the man, the perfect man. Now, let's look at John and we'll be finished for tonight. There's a whole lot. Now, we might get into a little bit when we get to Matthew and got maybe a little bit more time. Hold on to your notes about the intertestament period. There's a whole ton of stuff, and we're not going to get to that tonight because of time, but there's a whole ton of stuff. Now, I want you to go back, those of you who have your additional notes, to please go back and please take time to read it. Up until a few years ago, I hadn't really studied this intertestament period. What I mean by that is in between Malachi and Matthew, there's 400 years of silence. That there's no book of the Bible written, that God doesn't speak through an angel, God doesn't speak through a prophet, and so it's called Israel's Dark Ages, but there's a whole lot of things that happens historically between Malachi and Matthew, and even though that God, it doesn't mean God wasn't there, God wasn't speaking, there was no books written, but there's a whole lot that sets the stage for the New Testament. And when I began to study that, and I've tried to share what I've studied with you in these additional notes, and it will put a whole different light as you study the New Testament, especially the Gospels, and the customs and the manners and things that were going on in Jesus' day, and a lot of those things that happened. And we'll maybe touch on it briefly, but those of you that have the additional notes, please go back and read that. It's a little bit long and lengthy, but take time. There's a lot of good stuff there. Now, we come to the Gospel according to John, the last of these four Gospel records of Jesus Christ. And so Matthew presents Christ as King of the Jews. Mark presents Jesus as the suffering servant. Luke presents Jesus as the perfect man. And John presents Jesus as the eternal God. And he came to reveal and redeem. And we find this in the book of John. Now, in Matthew, Jesus is presented as the son of David. In Mark, there is no genealogy and lineage. I'm just tongue-tied tonight. So y'all got a good laugh tonight. So there is no history or record in the book of Mark about Jesus' lineage. I'll say it that way, and his genealogy. But in the book of Luke, the Son of Man goes back to Adam. But John is like Mark. There's no birth record in the book of John of Jesus. How does John chapter 1 and verse 1 open up? One of the most profound verses in all the Bible. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word what? Was God. And so John presents Jesus as the Son of God, eternally existent with God the Father, okay? And so the message of John is to the entire world. John 3:16, for God so loved the world, okay? And so it's to the whole world, and especially to the church. And then John's fulfillment of the seraphim's face will be the eagle. Of course, the eagle, we think of majesty, and we think of soaring above humanity there. And that's what God is. Emphasis on Christ's conversations. Now, in the book of John, you find more of Christ's private conversations than any other gospel record. You find Jesus speaking to Nicodemus. You find Jesus speaking to the woman at the well. You find Jesus speaking to the blind man there. In is it chapter 9, I believe it is. You find Jesus speaking with his disciples in chapters 13 through 17 there. The private conversations you'll find in the book of John. Now, let's go back to Isaiah. Let's connect John to the Old Testament. Isaiah chapter 40. Isaiah chapter 40. I'm almost done. This will be the last one. Isaiah chapter 40. And verse number 9. O Zion, that bringest good tidings, get thee up into the high mountain, O Jerusalem, that bringest good tidings, lift up thy voice with thy strength, lift it up, and be not afraid, say unto the cities of Judah, behold your God. So in Matthew, behold the king, behold my servant, behold the man. Now in John we see, behold your God. And so now we see here, as we look at these gospel records, next week we're going to get in the book of Matthew, and I'll try to squeeze in some of this intertestament period. But please, I encourage you, you'll learn so much if you study that intertestament period. And it'll make the New Testament make a whole different world of sense to you, historically speaking, and how Christ, as he came to this earth, what was going on. So we thank you tonight. We was a little bit long, but we was a little bit late getting started. So we got the bugs worked out. And so let's take a break for about 5 minutes. And Debbie, probably about at the bottom of the hour, we'll go back to the next class for pastor's class on the Christian home. And so be seeing then. Let's take a break.
All righty. Well, welcome back to School of the Bible and your second class for tonight and for the remainder of this semester is one. It's entitled The Christian Home. And if ever there's a time in our day, it's now, that we need to have Christian homes. We need to have Christian families. We're living in a time when they're trying to redefine the Christian home, the Christian family. And so we need to be more determined today than ever before to have a Christian home. And so a Christian home. And so the first lesson tonight is determined to have a Christian home. Have you made your mind up? Is your home going to be a Christian home? Is it going to be a home that pleases God? Well, God gives us some instructions on how to do that. So there, He has a working order for the Christian home. And we're going to go over a lot of these things in this class this semester. It'll be a good class, especially for the day that we find ourselves in. So if you have your book, you'd already have a book. You can open that up. I think it's page 4 in your book, lesson number 1. And you see right there in that little box is a phrase that you ought to remember. And it's a true phrase. It says, a Christian home is a home where people are living their Christian faith each day, every day. And so we must determine to have a Christian home. Many people today who are Christians, they do not have a Christian home. Why is that? Because they are not putting the things that God has instructed them to put in their home. They're putting the things of the world, and the things of the world doesn't mix with the things of God. And if your home is full of the things of the world, you will fail to have a Christian home because our world today is struggling. And the reason they're struggling, God has been thrown out of the homes and many of the workplaces and so forth, and thus we are suffering today. But we can determine in our minds to have a Christian home. So tonight, get your Bible, and we're going to be coming from the book of Colossians. Colossians chapter number 3, and your lesson actually has verses 15 through 21, but I'm going to begin reading tonight in verse 12. There's some things here I think it's important that we see as we look in verse 12. And talking about our homes. Now, when you talk about your home, there's three kinds of homes that every person must have. Three types of home. And I think you have these in your book, I believe. There's three types of home. First, we must have a what? Heavenly home. How do we have a heavenly home? Well, we get that one way, through Jesus Christ and the finished work at Calvary. By trusting Christ as our personal Savior, we get a heavenly home, not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to His precious blood. We have access to a heavenly home. Secondly, we should all have a church home. How important is it to have a church home? I mean, it's very important. It's very important to be involved in a church. If you're a Christian, you should be involved in a church. You should be a member of a local Bible preaching church, and you should be part of that church, faithful to that church. Have a church home. Now, you can't have a church home until you first have a heavenly home. Now, you can go to church, but it's not going to mean nothing to you until you know Christ as your Savior. So we need a heavenly home, and then we get us a church home, and then thirdly, we need to have a Christian home. We need to take what's taught in that church, what's taught in the fundamentals of the gospel, and take it home and make our homes a Christian home. Put God first. Bring the things of God into your house to make it a Christian home. And it's scary today, but unfortunately, a lot of people today claim to be Christians. Home is a war zone. They live in terror. They live in fear. It's a war zone. They're constantly fighting, bickering. And that is not the way God intended for a Christian home to be. So Colossians chapter 3, and we want to begin in verse 12 and 13. And God gives us, Paul gives us here some things from the Word of God of what we need to put on, what we need to dress ourselves with. And he begins in verse 12, says, put on therefore. When you see that word put on, it's what we're going to put on, our clothing. What are we going to wear? And in a Christian home, we need certain things to be there. Certain things must show up. So he says, put on therefore as the elect of God, as a child of God, as a chosen of God, a holy and beloved, and here he goes, bowels of mercies, kindness, humbleness of mind, meekness, long suffering. Look at all the things that he begins to name here, of the things we're to clothe ourselves in. When we clothe ourselves in mercy and in kindness and humbleness of mind and meekness and long suffering, when we have these things on, it'll lead to a Christian home. It'll make us act as if we belong to God. Notice verse 13, it goes on to talk about these things. Forbearing one another. In other words, sometimes we got to learn just to put up with each other. Amen. That's in our homes. That's in our church home. Amen. Now, come on now. You know what I'm talking about. Sometimes we just have to forbear one another. Look at this. Look at the next one. And what? Forgiving one another. Now, these are hard terms. These are terms where sometimes we have to swallow our pride in order to do. But what's going to make a Christian home? What's going to make a Christian church? What's going to make that? But our willingness to forgive, our willingness to bear one another's burdens. And it says in the rest of that verse, if any man have a quarrel against any, sometimes we do, don't we? Even as Christ forgave you, so also do ye. So see here, look here what Paul has done. He has thrown Christ into the equation. What has Christ done for us? Does Christ have a quarrel with us? I reckon so. He should anyway. But what has Christ done for us? He has forgiven us of our sins. And we should do the same. That's going to bring peace in a Christian home. And verse 14, and above all these things, here's the big article of we need to put on. And above all these things, put on what? Charity, which is? Love. Which is the bond of perfectness. And above all these, Paul says, let's just clothe ourselves in the love of God and the love of Christ. And let's clothe ourselves in here. And he says, which is the bond of perfectness. A home without love cannot be a Christian home. A church without love can't be a Christian church. And so he gives us some things here that we need to adorn ourselves with in order to help us to make our places a Christian home. So now he gives us the ingredients now of a Christian home. And he gives us this in verse 15 and 16 of Colossians chapter number 3. Look at verse 15. And let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to which ye also are called in one body, and be ye thankful. Verse 16, he goes on to say, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts unto the Lord. Now, let's talk about these. There's three ingredients that he gave us here that must be in the Christian home. What's the first one in verse 15? What's the first one? And let the peace of God rule in your heart. A truly Christian home is a place of peace with the peace of God ruling in each and every heart in the home. It's not a battleground. It's not a war zone. But a home should be a place of refuge, a place where we can come and get away from the war zone. Isn't it nice to go home and know that there's peace in your home when there's trouble and trials in the world? Isn't it good to have a place that you can go or get away from the troubles and the trials? That should be our home. That should be where our home is. It's not a place of fighting, but it ought to be a place of fellowship. Now, back to the book of Philippians, chapter number four, and verse 5-7, Paul mentions this. He says, rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice. Let your moderation be known unto all men. The Lord is at hand. Be careful for nothing, but in everything by prayer Supplication with thanksgiving in your heart, let your request be made known to God. Verse 7. And the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. You see, a place of peace. Our home should be a peaceful place, not a war zone. God has given us peace, and we need to operate in that peace. I want to read one passage of scripture out of Psalm 119. And in Psalm 119, of course, we know Psalm 119 is all about the Word of God, but in verse 165, this verse says this: "Great peace have they which love thy law, and nothing shall offend them." When we get the peace of God settled in our hearts, very little is going to offend us, because we have something the world doesn't have. Amen? Our home is a place of peace. Our heart is a place of peace. I tell you, some people are so easily offended today, and that's because they don't have no peace. There's no peace in their heart. So ingredient number one of a Christian home is peace. Number two, we find in verse 15 again, what is the second ingredient there to of a Christian home? He says, and let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to which also ye are called in one body, and be ye what? Thankful. Second ingredient in a Christian home would be thankfulness. Are we grateful for what God's given us? Are we grateful for the spirit we find in our home? Are we thankful for the time that we have together as family, when we can gather together in a place of peace and be thankful for a comfortable place and a safe place and a place that God has given us? You know, and we especially ought to enjoy the blessing of our home. If you got heat and lights, and you ought to be thankful. How many of us are thankful? How many of us are content with what God has given us? I'm afraid we're living in a world today that is not satisfied with the things that God has given them. They want more. They want something different. They want newer things. They want better things. What has happened with thank you, God, for what I've got? Amen. Thank you, God, for our family. You know, we ought to thank God our families are healthy. We ought to thank God that we're doing okay in a time of craziness in the world. You see, be thankful. So the second ingredient Paul gives us is thankfulness. Peace and thankfulness. And then the third, you get in verse 16, we're to be thankful for the Word of God. For he says, let the Word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom. Take time to read the Bible. Amen. You know, we live in a country, right now anyway, where there's Bibles everywhere. And most homes got more than one. I've got more than one at home. I've got more than one in my office. I've got more than one. You know, we got Bibles everywhere. But do we take that for granted? You see, we ought to be thankful that we have the Word of God. There is places where they do not have the Word of God. And when they get a copy, it's like gold to them, because they do not have it. And a Christian home should be a place that's filled with the Word of God. It ought to be found in everything we have, and talked about regularly. And so the Word of God, it must be in the Christian home. How can it be a Christian home without the Word of God? If you don't have the Word of God, then you got the word of the world. Amen. Amen. And you see, and then what happens then? Well, we got the world's philosophy and not God's philosophy. So three ingredients of a Christian home tonight: peace, thankfulness, and the Word of God. That ought to be in every Christian home. Now, the instruction in a Christian home, we get this in verse 16 and 17. We read part of 16, but let's look at it again and focus on the latter part of that verse. Let the Word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom, teaching, it says, and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. We need to have a teaching home. You know, what are we teaching in our homes? What is our family, our children, learning in our home? Do they see us respecting God? Do they see us honoring God? Is God honored in our home? And then and notice what else he tells us. He tells us to lift each other up, to help each other with what? Singing. You notice that? With music. Now, when we talk about music, you can get into some sticky subjects, right? But Christian homes should be homes filled with music. What kind of music? Music that honors God. Amen. Music that will bring this peace. Music that will bring this thankfulness. Music that will enhance the Word of God. Godly music is a vital part of instruction in the home and in the church. You know, godly music in the church, how it adds to the service. Amen. And how it enhances even the preaching of God's Word. But now you can take music and ruin it as well. You can get some of this music out today that invites the devil in. And then the devil gets involved and you got a mess. Amen. But here's the thing. There's instructions should be in our home as to what we allow in there and what is allowed to be brought into the home, what people are allowed to listen to. And there is so much out there today that so turns away this generation from God. And a lot of that's coming in through music and movies and literature and all those things. And we need to bring in what honors God and pleases God. Now, verse 17, he says, "And whatsoever ye do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God and the Father by him." So he gives us a couple things in verse 17. By the way, there is a difference between word and deed. Amen. In other words, are you doing what you're saying? Are you practicing what you preach? You know, we can say a lot of things, but are we doing what we say? Are we living what we are teaching? Because if your actions betrays your words, what kind of trust is the home going to have? There's going to be no trust. You can't believe what they say. You know, much like our government today. Amen. You can't believe nothing they say because their deeds don't match their words. We don't want our homes to be like that. You know, Lord, help us that we don't operate our homes like they operate the government. Amen. We'd have a mess. You see, be true to your word. Practice what you preach. Do what you say. Be an example in what is allowed to go on in the home. Now, it also says in verse 17, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus. Teach your families, teach your children that we are all accountable to Christ. We need to teach them that the best motive for doing right is what? To please who? To please Christ. Everything we do should be to please Christ, to be honoring to Christ. If it doesn't honor Christ, we ought not do it. And if it doesn't fall in line with our Bible, we ought not do it. And so he tells us, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus. Look what he says, giving thanks to God and the Father by him. Again, a call to be thankful. Thankful for what God has blessed us with. Thankful for God's help with us day by day. And it's so good to have a place. When we go home tonight, a place of peace where we can lay our head down on our pillow tonight and have this peace and thankfulness, knowing that no matter what happens, God's Word has promised us safety and has promised us rest with him. This whole world is wicked today. And by the way, can I tell you, our world today is not promoting Christian homes. They're promoting ungodly homes. They want all this ungodliness in there. And they thrive on that. They love that because they're of their father, the devil. And they want nothing that has to do with good. And we see that being promoted. And finally tonight, we have the individuals in a Christian home. And can I say this? God has given us specific individuals that's to be involved. And not only specific individuals, but He's given specific instructions for those individuals. Amen. And God has laid out the individuals that makes up a Christian home. Can I tell you who that is? That's dad and mom and the children. Amen. That's right. And nowhere in God's word do you find Him describing the Christian home as two men and children. Nowhere in the Christian home do you find where He describes the Christian home as one man, a transgender, and children. Hello? Do you find that anywhere? No. He gives us specific instructions to what the structured home should look like and the people that should be in the Christian home. So let's look at them. Beginning in verse 18, notice He begins with the wives. Wives. That's the woman. Amen. Yeah. Right out there in your Bible, if you write in your Bible, that's the woman. That's right. And notice what the instruction to the woman. Submit yourselves unto your own husband as is fit in as is fit in the Lord. You see, the word God gives for the wives is the word submit. What does that mean? That means you're to be a helper. You are to step in there and help your husband. By the way, God has put the husband in charge of the household. And men, we'll talk about you in just a minute. God's gave you a great responsibility. But women, wives today, God's given you a responsibility. And that responsibility is to help your husband to govern his home according to the Word of God. Now, I know there's circumstances and things that happen, but God has given us an order. And that order belongs to God. And this is the workings of the Christian home. And so the wife is to be submissive to the husband's leadership. Now, verse 19, husbands, look here. Love your wives and be not bitter against them. Now, God's instruction to the husband is what? Love your wife. Love them. Now, He would tell them in the book of Ephesians, I think it is, to love your wife as Christ so loved what? The church. And how did Christ love the church? He gave Himself for it. He died for it. You see. And men, we are to love our wives. We are to be ready in a moment's notice to give our life up for our wives. And you see, because God has given them to us and given to us to help us and for us to love, and together the husband and the wife then makes the Christian home. God has put the husband in charge, the wife to be submissive so that the home can function as God's order. You put this out of order and the home doesn't function according to God's order. You try to sneak in any other way, and your home's not going to function as a Christian home. You can't bring ungodliness in the home and expect God to bless it. You can't live ungodly in your home and expect God to bless it. Many families today and many homes today are a mess and a wreck, but they scratch their head and wonder why. It's because they need to do some cleaning out. They need to make their home a Christian home and get rid of some things and begin learning how to submit to some things. Now, notice what else we get in verse, the next verse here, verse 20. Children. Now, this is a product of mom and dad, the children. Children born into the household. What is their responsibility? Obey your parents in all things. Uh-oh. He didn't say obey your parents in what you like. Is that what he said? No. He said, children, obey your parents in all things, for this is well-pleasing unto the Lord. One of the Ten Commandments is what? Honor thy father and thy mother. And so it's important today, children. God give you parents for a reason. And especially if you've got godly Christian parents, you ought to be thankful for that. And you should obey your parents and listen to your parents, because this is what pleases God. To obey, that means to listen And he says, in all things. I know when I was growing up, I didn't always like what mom had to say. I didn't always like mom's answer. But you find out later on in life that mom knew what she's talking about. And that dad knew what they're talking about. And they do it for our good, to help us so we can have a good life, a fulfilling life, and so we can live a long life. Now, a lot of people's lives cut short in this life because they don't want to obey God's order. And they want to make up their own order. And thus we see tragedy often come from that. And then if you'll notice, in verse 21, he mentions fathers. Now, notice what it says about fathers. Fathers, provoke not your children to anger, lest they be discouraged. A father is to be a disciplinarian. He should be, he's supposed to be, he better be. But then also is to be an encourager and a helper, you see, to the children. He's not to provoke the children to anger. He's not to have unreasonable demands this can be done by hypocrisy, unrealistic expectations, or by unforgiving spirit. Don't put demands upon your children they can't do, and don't ridicule them if they make a mistake. Sometimes punishment has to be, but there's a right way to punish. There's a wrong way to punish, and there's nothing wrong with punishment. Matter of fact, we probably don't have enough of it in our homes anymore. Children are running wild, and many homes, the children are the boss. And mom and dad's not the boss, and that's not the way it's supposed to be. Dad is supposed to be the head of the household. Mom's to be the helpmeet to dad, and the children are to obey mom and dad. And when the children mess up, we're to have forgiving spirits at the same time with discipline. And sometimes mom and dad messes up. Amen? And we have to be ready to admit that. And even if it means making apologies, I know that's a hard word, but even if it means that we have to make apologies. You see, God has given us the right way to conduct a Christian home. And we are to determine. I wonder how many people today in our world has made up their mind to have a Christian home. As for me and my house, you see, we're just going to obey the Lord. And we're going to follow God and believe the Bible. And so tonight, and as we go through this, this is a great series of lessons, especially today in which we live. And, we may need to take some things out of our home. We may need to replace some things in our home. We must always put things right with God, you see. God's Word teaches us this. And to make this a home that will be filled with peace and with thankfulness and with kindness and mercy and grace. And God has given us all duties in that Christian home. Fulfill your duty. Don't be angry with somebody else. Don't be jealous because you think you should have a better job than somebody else. And let's talk just a minute about our church home. You know, we all have our physical home, but we also have our church home. And that's one of the homes we need as well. We need a heavenly home, we need a church home, and we need a Christian home. In the church home, Satan wants nothing more than to get some type of anger sparked up or jealousy sparked up. You know, and how come? We hear that all the time in the church. How come you did this, or how come you didn't do that, or how come you did more for this one and didn't do for that one? You see, those are enemy words. Those don't belong in the house. We need to be satisfied with what God has given us. The Bible commands us to be content with such as God has given us. And I think it's Hebrews. Let me turn over to the book of Hebrews, chapter 13. And verse number 5. Let your conversation be without covetousness, and be content with such things as ye have. For he has said, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. When we get a hold of that, and we can be satisfied with what God's doing, then let me tell you, you'll have a Christian home. When you learn what God has said, Do what God has said. In your home, in your church, you see, you will have that Christian home. So tonight, determine to have that Christian home. Now, next week, we're going to continue on studying this, but next week, we're going to talk about marriage. Another thing our world today wants to redefine. They want to redefine the home, and we're going to talk about marriage by, what is the name of that lesson I got here? Marriage by divine design. God has set a marriage order, and we'll get into the Word of God, and we'll talk about marriage and what the Bible has said, and of course, you know our world today. My goodness, it's a mess. Need to pray for our world today as they're trying to destroy the God-given Christian home. Determine to have a Christian home. God bless you. Thank you. We'll be right back. Ready.
our last lesson tonight, and I'll try to make try to catch up on our time here a little bit. We might be 5 minutes over or so, but we're going to talk about teaching the Bible. You say, well, I don't plan on being a Sunday school teacher. I'm not going to be a teacher. But listen, we're going to get into this tonight. We're all teachers in some way or another. Are you a parent tonight? Are you a grandparent? Are there children in your life some way? Then you're a teacher, and we're going to see that tonight. And so here's ways that we can do this effectively. Now, Pastor talked about the Christian home, and this is where our teaching has to begin, in the home. That's why our nation's in the mess that it's in right now, because our home's in the mess. Out of the three institutions that God has given, the home was the first, and it's the most important. The home, the government, and the church. And boy, we can't depend on the government now, but God instituted the right kind of government, but governments will fall apart. We can't put all the responsibility on the church, but a church is only as strong as its people and as its homes within the church. And so in order for the church to be strong, in order for the government to be strong, we need to have strong homes, as Pastor was talking about. And so that teaching, as it's tied into this lesson, begins in the home. God gives that first responsibility of teaching to the mother and father. And so we see that. Now, let's look at our lesson tonight, lesson one, Bible patterns for the Bible teachers. So if we want to be Bible teachers, we need to know what the Bible says in order for us to teach the Bible, right? And what God expects of us as Bible teachers, okay? And so as we look in the Word of God, we find that the Bible itself contains patterns that we must follow in teaching Scriptures to others. So Jesus never asked us to do anything that He did not give us the example of first how to do. Of course, the greatest teacher and preacher that ever walked across the face of planet Earth was Jesus Christ. And we learn from His example, obviously. But there are many other examples in the Scriptures that we have to learn how to be an effective Bible teacher. Okay, and so the Old Testament patterns for Bible teachers we'll look at tonight, some of these. Let's look at Moses. He was an effective Bible teacher. Go back to the book of Exodus, chapter number 24. And we're going to see some important patterns here, looking at a few of these examples that God gives us, how we are to pattern our teaching ministry that God has given us all. And it doesn't necessarily have to be in a Sunday school. Doesn't have to be in a Christian school. It could be in your home. We would encourage you to work in a Sunday school class, to work in a bus ministry, to work in our youth program, and we encourage, I encourage all of my youth teachers, and many of them have already gone through our School of the Bible. We encourage them to take this School of the Bible for them to learn. In order for you to teach, you got to know something, right? You know, we got a lot of teachers out there that are teaching stuff they don't know about. And so if we're going to teach, we need to know what we're teaching. So we find these examples in Exodus 24. Look at Moses in verse 1. This is God speaking, and He said unto Moses, come up unto the Lord, thou and Aaron, Nadab and Abihu, and 70 of the elders of Israel, and worship ye afar off. Now notice what it says in verse number 2. And Moses, what? Alone shall come near the Lord, but they shall not come nigh, neither shall the people go up with him. And Moses came and told all the people all the words of the Lord. And Moses came and told the people all the words of the Lord and all of the judgments. And all the people answered with one voice and said, all of the words which the Lord has said, we will do. Now look over in verse 12. And the Lord said unto Moses, come up unto me into the mount, and there, and I will give thee tables of stone, and a law, and commandments which I have written, that thou mayest teach them. And Moses rose up, and his minister Joshua, and Moses went to the mount of God. And he said unto the elders, tarry ye here for us, until we come again unto you. And behold, Aaron and Hur are with you, and if any man shall have any matters, let them come to them. And Moses went up into the mount, and the cloud covered the mount, and the glory of the Lord abode about Mount Sinai, and the cloud covered it 6 days. And the seventh day he called unto Moses out of the midst of the cloud, and the sight of the glory of the Lord was like a devouring fire on the top of the mount in the eyes of the children of Israel. And Moses went into the midst of the cloud and got him up into the mount, and Moses was in the mount 40 days and 40 nights. Okay, so let's see here. Moses was chosen to take God's word to his people. Now here's a blank for you to fill out. He had nothing to say until he had been what with God? Alone with God. That's the first step of any Bible preacher and any Bible teacher. If we're going to be effective Bible teachers and Bible preachers, whether it be in our homes or our church, wherever we're at in our Christian school, we must spend time alone with God. You know, I've tried to tell our youth leaders and teachers, and we have some excellent people that helps our young people here at Maranatha Baptist Church. We thank God. They're faithful people. But I tell them many times, we don't just need warm bodies to fill positions. We don't need people to just take a kid's Sunday school class and color pictures of Noah's Ark for the next 3 years. They're put there to teach them the Bible and to be the example. And so in order for you to be an effective teacher, in order for me to be an effective teacher and a preacher of the gospel, then we must spend time alone with God. And that's what Moses was doing. So God was relaying the thoughts and God was relaying His laws and commandments to Moses. And then Moses was to relay that to the people. And it's the same with us. God reveals to us, and I'm constantly praying, and I know Pastor Mills does the same thing. Before we get up and preach or teach on any subject, we spend time in prayer asking, God, what do you want us to give to the people? We don't want to just stand in front of people and try to impress you with our eloquence, and you've already seen that tonight. Mine's not very good. I can't even say genealogy. But we're not trying to impress you with our oratory ability. Now, I believe we ought to do the best we can, the efforts and abilities God's given us, but the most important part of our ministry is what the Lord has told us to relay to the people. We are imparting truth. And whether that be as a parent, as a grandparent, as a Sunday school teacher, as a youth worker, as a Sunday school class, whatever you're doing, we are imparting and relaying truth. Peter said to feed the flock of God. That's our job. As parents and leaders and teachers, we're feeding others the truth. And so Moses spent time alone with God, and then he relayed God's message and taught God's message to the people. And so there must be a go-between, and that teacher and that preacher is the go-between. Okay, and then number two, we find the example of the Jewish family. Now here's where it's going to hit home. You say, I'm not a teacher. All right, I'm getting ready to show you where the Word of God you are. Deuteronomy chapter 6. So did everybody get that blank in your book that he had nothing to say until he'd been alone with God? Alone with God is your blank there for number one. Roman number two, the Jewish family was an example of teaching. And again, as I said earlier, the Christian home has to be right. The teaching has to begin in our homes. We can't just depend on sending our kids to church. You know, a lot of these kids we bring to church, you know, we only get them at best maybe 2 or 3 hours a week. But they're constantly in your home and that environment. And we can do the best that we can, and we try to do the best we can to teach them the Bible, to show them the right way to live, to be the example. But the reality of it is they only spend 3 or 4 hours a week with us. And so you multiply 24 times 7, whatever that number is, how many hours there are in a week, the majority of that time, 95, 98, 99% of that time is spent at home. And that's why God expects us, the church, is to reinforce the home, but it's not to take the place of the teaching in the home. Look in Deuteronomy chapter 6 and verse number 4. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. And thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thine heart and all thy soul and with all thy mind. And these words which I command thee this day shall be in thine heart. Now notice verse 7. And thou shalt teach them diligently. That means it requires discipline. It requires staying after it. It requires, and I'm telling you, it's hard to do. And I'll be the first one to admit to you, and I'm not going to lie to you, there's times that I fail in my family devotion times. I have a personal devotion with God every day, but there's sometimes I'm here at the church or working all evening. I'm not making excuses, but I fail, and I have to take the accountability as the leader of my home, spiritual leader of my home, and I've asked God to help me with that and to try to work around those things and knowing when I'm going to be busy ahead of time. But it's our responsibility to diligently pursue that. And thou shalt teach them diligently unto thy children, and thou shalt talk of them when thou sittest in thine house, and when thou talkest by the way, and when thou liest down, and when thou risest up. I hope talking about the Bible is something that we just don't do on Sundays when we come to church, right? Verse 8, and thou shalt bind them for a sign upon thine hand, and shall be as frontlets between thine eyes, and thou shalt write them upon the post of thy house and thy gates. And so teaching begins in the home. Every generation bears the responsibility to teach the next generation. That begins in the home. Okay, we're going to help you as a church do all we can, but the church is not the substitute for the home, the foundation for those lives. And man, this hit me one day as a father. It hit me like a sledgehammer between the eyes. That one day, that I realized one day, it's been many years ago, but I realized that those children that God allowed me to have, that's placed within my care, they were given to me by God, and they are eternal souls that I am responsible for, that I'm responsible to teach the Bible as their father, as their parent, as the leader of their home. It's my God-given responsibility to teach them the Bible. I can't save them. I can't make them live a Christian life, but that is not what God asked me to do. God told me to teach them. God tells us to train them, to show them the right way. Here is the way. Walk in it. And that's what we do in our homes. Now, let's read a couple failures here in the Bible. What happens if we neglect to do our job? Look in the book of Judges chapter 2. Judges chapter 2 and verse number 10. And this describes where we're at in America today. And the problem is not the government. It's not the presidency. It's not the state. It's not the local governments. The problem is not necessarily with the church. The problem is with the Christian home. Look in Judges 2:10, and here's what we get when we don't do our jobs and our responsibilities as parents and teachers, which begins in the home. And also all that generation, the Joshua generation, were gathered unto their fathers, and there arose another generation after them which knew not the Lord, nor yet the works which he had done for Israel. Why did they not know the works of the Lord? Remember, God told them back in Deuteronomy to tell them, to rehearse them, to set up memorials, to set up these stones. And when your children ask you, what are these stones? What are these landmarks? What are these memorials? What does my heritage mean? We are to tell them what God has done for us. We are to share with them how to come to Christ. We are to teach them, not only by what the Bible says, how to live the Christian life, but for us to be the example to show them how to live the Christian life. And when we fail to do that, then we get a generation. The generation after Joshua's generation died, the Bible said there arose up another generation that knew not the Lord. And boy, I'm telling you, that's where we're at today. Many young people know nothing of the Lord, know nothing of God. And some of them come to church every week, and some of them know nothing of the Lord because they're not taught that in their homes. And may God help us. May God help me to be the father and the teacher and the parent that God has called us to be, teaching the Word of God. Then if you'll look, notice in Judges 21, verse 25, the sad commentary of the book of Judges. Judges 21, 25, and this is the attitude of the day. There's a whole generation that knew nothing of the Lord, and this is the result in verse 25. And in those days, there was no king in Israel, and every man did that which was right in his own eyes. Boy, that's a commentary on America today. That's why we're living in a mess. I'm not going to be popular for saying this, but I don't care. I'm going to preach the truth, and I wear a size extra large orange coveralls if you need to give me some. And so you just bring them. But the reason we're in a mess in America today, their kids don't know whether they're male or female. They don't know whether who to marry or not. They're worried about what bathroom they can go into. It's because we as parents are failing to teach them the Word of God. Everybody's doing what's right in their own eyes. We're living in a day of relativism, of absolute, and there's no absolutes. It's all relative. How do you want to perceive it? How I want to live, how I want to act. There's no biblical conviction. And many people that call themselves Christians are okay with that. God help us, and God forbid. You want to know why Washington's in a mess today? It's because our Christian homes are failing. And everybody's doing that which is right in their own eyes. And may God help us to have a revival. We're going to see here in our next passage that there was revival because there was a teaching and an emphasis on the Word of God. And may God help us. I'm preaching now, not teaching, but it's just stirring my heart because this is what we need. And may God help us tonight to be the teachers of the Bible that God wants us to be. And so look at this. Every parent, this is your blank, is to be a Bible teacher. Every parent is to be a Bible teacher. Begins in the home. And every grandparent. We have a lot of grandparents raising and spend a lot of time with their grandchildren because either mom and dad works or home situations are not what they should be. But listen, as that grandparent, be that biblical influence. Be that godly influence in that child's life. It's what they need. It's what God wants you to be for them. Step up to the plate and God help us. Now, we see the example in Jehoshaphat's revival. And boy, I was stirred. Let's look in 2 Chronicles 17. And as I was reading this today, boy, God stirred my heart. Where we are in America today. And I believe that we can still see revival. Yeah, the world's a mess. The White House is a mess. But listen, God's still in control. God's Word still as powerful as it ever was. And you and I, if we will put emphasis on it, if we will teach it and do what we should do and step up, then we, I believe, can see revival. But we find that in Jehoshaphat's revival. Notice in 2 Chronicles chapter 17. Let's read verses 1 through 10. And Jehoshaphat, his son, reigned in his stead and strengthened himself against Israel. And he placed forces in all the fenced cities of Judah and set garrisons in the land of Judah and in the cities of Ephraim and which Asa his father had taken. Now Jehoshaphat, he's a king of Judah, okay? This is after the split. All right, verse 3. And the Lord was with Jehoshaphat. Look why. This is why God blessed him. This is why God honored him. This is why God raised him up. Because he walked in the first ways of his father David and sought not unto Balaam. Now, in these kings, you'll find if they did right, it always refers that they walked in the ways of their fathers David. If they did wrong, it always goes back and said they walked in the ways of their father Rehoboam, which rebelled against God. And notice this in verse 4, but he sought the Lord God of his father, and he walked in his commandments, and not after the doings of Israel. He wasn't doing what everybody else was. He wasn't worried about what the crowd wanted. He wasn't worried about being the popular candidate in the election. He was worried about what God said that he should be doing. Verse number 5, therefore the Lord established the kingdom in his hand. You want to know why DC's in a mess? Because they're not seeking the Lord tonight. And all of Judah brought to Jehoshaphat presents and have riches and honor and abundance. God blessed him for his stand. And his heart was lifted up in the ways of the Lord. He wasn't corrupt. He wasn't seeking self-gain. He wasn't interested in the money. He was interested in the Lord. And moreover, he took away the high places and the groves out of Judah. He rose up and was a leader that the people could follow and believe. I'm going to get in trouble. It's all right, though. Also, in the third year of his reign, he sent unto his princes, unto Ben-Hail, and to Obadiah, and to Zechariah, and to Nethaneel, and to Micaiah, to teach in the cities of Judah. So now he's got his heart right with the Lord. He's where he, as the national leader, needs to be the example the people can follow, the people can trust, the people can follow his guidance, and now he's sending out teachers in his country. Notice what it says in verse number 8, and with them he sent the Levites, even Shemaiah and Nethaniah and Zebadiah and Ashiel and Shemariah-moth and Jehonathan and Adonijah and Tobijah and Tob-Adonijah and Levites and with them Elishama and Jehoram, priest. Now notice verses 9 and 10. And they taught in Judah and had the book of the law of the Lord with them and went about throughout all of the cities of Judah and what? Taught the people. And the fear of the Lord fell upon all the kingdoms of the lands that were round about Judah so that they made no war against Jehoshaphat. You know why they had revival? Because number one, the national leader got himself right with the Lord. He was exposed before God and God knew his heart and he sought the ways of the Lord. And when he got his heart right with God, there were teachers that raised up that he commissioned to go throughout all the land and teach the Bible. You know how America's going to be saved today? If our national leaders would be convicted of their sins and get their heart right with God and be saved and turn their face to the Lord and repent and ask for God's mercy and forgiveness, and then the Bible preachers and teachers of America in our homes and in our churches and in our schools will stand up and take a stand for Jesus Christ and teach the Word of God, then and only then will we see a change in this nation. May God help us tonight. I'm getting fired up, but that's all right. Then the example of Ezra the scribe. Let's look at the book of Ezra. My heart has been stirred in these by the Word of God today because our nation is in a mess. But I'm telling you, there is hope, but we have to do it God's way. Ezra, the book of Ezra, we see the example of a godly Bible teacher. In Ezra chapter 7 and verse number 10, again, notice here Ezra the ready scribe in verse 10 of chapter 7, for Ezra had prepared his heart to seek the law of the Lord and to do it and to teach in Israel the statutes and judgments. Notice number one, Ezra, before he could teach the people, what did he have to do? And it's in perfect order in your Bible. He had to what? He had to prepare his own heart. If I'm going to teach to you, I have to prepare my heart. I have to spend time with God alone. I have to spend time in the Word of God. You know, people think that the preacher only works 2 days a week, on Wednesdays and on Sundays. But can I tell you, a preacher that's doing it for, that's been called by God and who wants to give his people something, it takes hours of time studying and praying and meditating and throughout all the interruptions and the phone calls and everything else that happens during the week. But it takes time to study. But Ezra prepared his own heart first. If I'm going to help somebody else, I have to be right with God first. And he prepared his heart to seek the law of the Lord, and then not only to seek God's will, but then what did he have to do? He had to go do it. The Bible said that we're not to just be hearers of the word, but to be doers. If we're going to teach somebody, and boy, here's what I'm trying to beat into, and again, we have a great group of teachers here at Maranatha Baptist Church, and I don't say beat this, but what I try to enforce and what I try to build a foundation for is to teach them to be faithful. You're not just up there in front of a bunch of kids to write something on a chalkboard. You're an example for them. And I don't care if you're in a K-3 class. I don't care if you're in a kindergarten class. I don't care if you're dealing with high school seniors or college-age kids. You, as a teacher, are an example, and you need to be faithful. And if you're not faithful, then we don't need you to be teaching. Amen? That's just the truth of it. All right, not trying to be mean and ugly. But how can you help somebody else when you're not where you need to be as a teacher? How can I help somebody else if I'm not where I need to be as a teacher? Okay? And then once he was ready to seek the law of God, he prepared, he performed to do the work, and then he was able to teach. Then he was able to teach. Now look in Nehemiah chapter 8. We'll find Ezra again over here in the book of Nehemiah chapter 8. And I want you to, let's read verses 1 through 13 again. I was stirred up here reading this today in the book of Nehemiah, talking about teaching the Bible and the examples that we have to follow in the Bible. We need to spend time alone with God. We need to prepare our hearts. We need to do the will of God, not just talk about it, but be the example, not in just word by teaching, but an example by doing. And then we need to teach the people. Now notice, now watch these patterns in Nehemiah chapter 8. And all, in verse 1, and all the people gathered themselves together as one man. The people were in unity for one reason. You know why we're in a mess today? Because our people won't come together. Half of them scared, half of them's running this way, half of them don't care anymore, won't come back to church and because of other reasons. It has nothing to do with illness. And you know, here's what we got nowadays. But we all need to come together. And we understand people are sick, and we're not condemning that, but I'm just telling you, there's a lot of people out there taking advantage of this pandemic that ought to be in the house of God. Amen? I might be looking for a job tomorrow, but that's all right. And all the people gathered themselves together as one man into the street that was before the water gate, and they spake unto Ezra the scribe to bring the book of the law of Moses, which the Lord had commanded to Israel. And Ezra the priest brought the law before the congregation. He was standing before them to present something to them. Before the congregation of both men and women and all that could hear with understanding upon the first day of the seventh month. Now notice in verse 3 what he does. He's before the people. They're gathered together, all who has understanding, from the youngest to the oldest, who can understand. In verse 3, and he read therein before in the street that was before the water gate, and from the morning until midday, before the men and the women and those that could understand, and the ears of all the people were attentive to the book of the law. They were listening. He had something to give them. He had a message from the Lord, and the people were attentive to listen. Our job is to teach. Your job is to listen and absorb that. And then you as a Bible teacher, your purpose and your responsibility, whether it be in the home or at the church, is to teach others also, to absorb. And you need to learn. Before I can be a teacher and a preacher, I have to learn. I have to study. I have to teach. That's why Pastor Mills and I, sometimes we go off to these conferences, because you know why? The preachers need preaching. The preachers need to be taught. The preachers need to be encouraged, just like you, if we're to help our people. And that's what he's doing. And notice verse 4, and Ezra the scribe stood upon a pulpit of wood, which they had made for the purpose. The pulpit was made for a purpose of reading and relaying the word of God to the people. And this bunch that takes away the pulpits and replaces them with nothing and walks around with their zebra pants or whatever on, it's not biblical. Amen. And beside him stood Matthiah and Shemei and Anani and Urijah and Hilkiah and Maaseiah, and on this right hand and on this left, and Padiah and Mishael and Malachi and Hashem and Hashbandana and Zechariah and Mashalem. And Ezra opened the book in the sight of all the people. So you see today I'm reading from the Bible. I'm not reading from USA Today. I'm not reading from Time Magazine. I'm not reading from Popular Mechanics. I'm reading from the Holy Word of God, the King James Bible. And Ezra opened the book in the sight of all the people, for he was above all the people. And when he opened it, all the people stood up. They had something much of us don't have today, respect for God's Word. And Ezra blessed the Lord, the great God, and all the people answered, amen and amen. That means that they were responding in a way of saying, he's communicating truth. I agree with that. That's what amen means. With lifting up their hands, and they bowed their heads and worshiped the Lord with their faces to the ground. Notice that. They lifted up their hands. That's always praise in the Bible. And then notice they bowed their heads. That's always worship. Bowing is always associated with worship. Praise is always associated with lifting up. And it was all centered around the reading and teaching of God's Word. And Jeshua and Bani and Shabbai and Jamam and Akeb and Shabani and Hodijah and Maaseiah and Kelatah and Azariah and Jozabad and Hanan and Peliah and the Levites caused the people to understand the law, and the people stood in their place, and so they read the book and the law of God distinctly and gave the sense and caused them to understand the reading. That's your job and my job as a teacher, for us to give the sense. What is the Bible saying? What truth are we trying to teach you? You know, when we color a picture of Noah's Ark, you know, that's okay for three-year-olds, but you need to be teaching them why what happened at Noah's Ark. You don't just need to be coloring a picture. That's not doing anything. Going outside and playing jumping jacks, that's not teaching kids anything about God. Amen? We need to make sense of the Bible. Teach God distinctly. Not bring them to church to watch a movie. Teach them the Word of God and cause them to understand the reading. And Nehemiah, which was the Tirshatha, which is the word for governor, and Ezra the priest, the scribe, and the Levites that taught the people, said unto all the people, this day is holy unto the Lord your God, mourn not nor weep, for all the people wept when they heard the words of the law. You know what was going on? Teaching the Bible brings conviction. And I've said this a million and three times, the reason today that people do not have biblical convictions is because they have no knowledge of the Bible. Knowledge of the Word of God produces biblical convictions in your life. We have people say, well, that doesn't bother me. I'm not convicted about it. It makes you wonder sometimes. The reason that they're not convicted is because they don't know what the Bible says. But when the Bible is taught, and when the Bible is presented, and I don't care if you're teaching a kindergarten class, you're teaching 12th graders, I don't care if you're standing in front of 3,000 preachers, it doesn't matter. You need to be communicating truth, making sense of that, and the Word of God is the power. The Word of God brings conviction. The Word of God is the sharp two-edged sword. But we as teachers need to know how to yield the sword, right? And then he said unto them, go your way and eat the fat and drink the sweet and send the portions unto them for whom nothing is prepared. For this day is holy unto the Lord. Neither be ye sorry, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. And so the Levites steeled all the people and saying, hold your peace, for this day is holy. Neither be ye grieved. And all the people went their way to eat and to drink and send portions and to make great mirth because they had understood the words that were declared to them. There was great joy because now the people had an understanding of the law of God. Now, I don't have time to get back into this story about Nehemiah and Ezra, but remember, they just come out of captivity. Many of them had not known what the law of Moses said. They had lost that during the captivity. They couldn't even speak in the original Hebrew language. They couldn't read it, and that's what these scribes were assigned to do, to teach them the Bible. And now there was joy in their heart when they learned what God wanted for them. And so we'll stop right there. I'm preaching tonight. But listen, revival was a result of the teaching of God's Word. Now, in the New Testament on your next page, we have the patterns of Bible teachers. And of course, we said the greatest teacher of all time, the greatest preacher of all time was the Lord Jesus Christ. And if we want to be effective Bible teachers in our homes, in our churches, whatever aspect of life we're teaching in, and that teaching ministry, which would expand to many areas of our life, we need to look at Christ's example. Teaching was a vital part of Jesus Christ's earthly ministry. And who, since Jesus went back to heaven, who has the teaching ministry now? Now, hold on a minute. Let's go back to page four. I skipped three blanks. I was preaching and I forgot about your blanks. I'm sorry. I'll go back and give you the blanks. Under Jehoshaphat's revival, teaching of the Word of God is necessary for the preservation of our nation. I'm sorry. Back to Roman numeral 3 on the first page. Teaching of the Word of God is necessary for the preservation of our nation. And then under Ezra the scribe, Ezra had prepared his heart because he had a willing heart. Prepared is your word there. And then the people understood, under Nehemiah, the people needed someone to help them to understand the law of God. To understand the law of God. Did you get that? Okay. So to preserve our nation, Ezra prepared his heart and to understand the law of God. Now, over to the New Testament, the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, when Jesus went back to heaven, who has the ministry or who took over his ministry of teaching? Who lives within us? The Holy Spirit of God, okay? And so in John 14:26, you say, preacher, I don't know what to say. You know how many times I've told the Lord that? I don't know what to preach. I don't know what to say. And I don't have no excuse because he takes me to this verse. In John 14:26, but the Comforter, that's the Holy Spirit, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things and bring all things into your remembrance whatsoever I've said unto you. And then in chapter 16, verse 13, howbeit when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth. For he will not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, he shall speak and will show you things to come. So the Holy Spirit's our teacher. All right, the Sermon on the Mount is known as Christ's greatest discourse. All right, one of his greatest teaching. Now, you didn't know it, but you're going to have homework next week. All right, here's your assignment. You got two things, assignments. Assignment number one is to read through Matthew chapter 5 through 7. That's the Sermon on the Mount. And I want you to bring a list of some of the methods Christ used in his teaching. So while you're reading Matthew 5, Matthew 6, and Matthew 7, see if you can. There's no right or wrong answers. You're not going to get a grade. You're not going to fail the class. But this is just something to see if you can pick out, for you to kind of learn this on your own, study on your own, and to see if you can pick out some examples that Christ used. And we'll go over some of these. And maybe compare answers next week and show you. But there's many different styles the Lord uses in those chapters to teach. Notice how he communicated to the people. What examples he gave. Did he use symbols? Did he relate? How did he relate things? So just some common things. And there's no right or wrong answer. So you're not going to be put on the spot. But we'll talk about those next week. And then we find the teaching of the Apostle Paul. The Apostle Paul, one of the great teachers and preachers. After Christ there. Paul was mightily used of God and he taught and preached the gospel of Christ. And so your assignment for next week for Paul is to read Acts 13 verses 14 through 43. Acts 13 verses 14 through 43 and see some of the ways that Paul taught. What did Paul use? Now, different people's going to do things a little bit differently. They're going to be to the same point. They're preaching the same gospel and the same message. But remember, we said God uses our individual traits and abilities. So understand that. Now, let's look at this last example of the first century believers. You have a blank here. Teaching is a part of the Great Commission. Teaching is a part of the Great Commission. And I'll read this in Matthew 28:19. And I know we're a little bit over. We got a little bit of a late start, but that's all right. Matthew 28:19. The Great Commission. Jesus says, go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever commanded you. And lo, I'm with you always, even to the end of the world. Amen. And so, we're to communicate truth. That's what teaching is. You're communicating truth, whether it be to your children, grandchildren, in a Sunday school class at church, in a master club class at church, a Sunday night class at church, working in a Christian school, working just with any kind of audience where God has placed you, especially young people, to teach them the Bible. It's part of the Great Commission. We're to get people saved, and then we're to show them and teach them how to live the Christian life. And this is one of the greatest failures of our church today. Sometimes we're good at getting the gospel out, handing out tracts, but discipling people and teaching them is where we need to work. So we need to attention to that. Teaching was a vital part of the ministry of the first century churches. So look in Acts 5:42. We'll look at these two verses and be done tonight. Acts chapter 5 and verse 42. The emphasis in the early church in verse 42, and daily in the temple and to every house, and in every house they cease not to teach and to preach Jesus Christ. And then look at what Paul says to Timothy in 2 Timothy 2. And for all of you who are teachers filling a teaching position, I want you to read this. But this applies to the home as well, especially to parents. 2 Timothy 2:2. And the things that thou hast heard of me among many witnesses, the same commit thou to faithful men who shall be able to teach others also. The Bible says it's required of a steward so that a man be found faithful, but also not only just stewards, but teachers. And so teachers, you're an example. You're not just by what you say, but as Pastor said in Colossians, by word and deed, what we say and what we do. You know, how can you expect to award your young people Sunday school awards and you never come to Sunday school yourself? What kind of teacher? What kind of example? You say, well, they're just kindergartners, but I'm telling you, I can look back in my life now, I'm 46 years old, and I can look back in my life now and I remember the people and teachers, the godly examples that I had growing up in church as a kindergartner, as a first grader, and people that had an impact and made an impression in my life because they were faithful, because they loved God. Not just, and you know, I remember more of that than probably the lessons that they taught me. You know, I couldn't go back to a certain day, and Stephanie's in here tonight. She used to be one of our Awana helpers. And I probably couldn't go back, Stephanie, when I was in junior high and tell you what the lesson was, but I remember Stephanie was there every week. I remember she was faithful, and that stuck with me. And I've tried to go back now at this point in my life and thank people as I see them for being faithful and helping me, because I appreciate that. But you make a difference in somebody's life, whether it be in the home or wherever it's at. We are all called to be teachers. Well, we thank you, and we're a little bit long tonight, but we're going to finish up. And next week, we'll be back here, Lord willing, Tuesday, and we will start in the book of Matthew, and then we'll continue on the Christian home and teaching the Bible. May God help us to be what we need to be. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this night and those who have been patient and those who have been here tonight, and Lord, those who will watch via live stream, we ask you to bless us. Father, help our people, protect them. Lord, pray for our nation especially. These are critical days, but Lord, we just need people that will stand for God and do right and teach the Bible. So help us to do that and live for you in Jesus' name. Amen.